Good morning, church.
Good morning.
This is the day that the Lord has made. I have a special introduction to make this morning, and I'm going to walk down here to introduce Bridget Dickerson, our new administrative secretary. Bridget. Say hello to Bridget.
Hi, Bridget.
I can't help it. They're just that kind of people. We're delighted to have Bridget join us as administrative secretary. She began work just this very past Monday, and she has not quite mastered everybody's name yet. So I'm going to ask you, for the foreseeable future, when you meet Bridget, just cut to the quick and say, "Hello, Bridget, my name is." Will you do that for us?
Yes.
Good, good, good. We welcome Bridget, and we also welcome her husband, Charles, here, who's also a pastor. And Bridget, say a few words.
Good morning, everyone. I just want to say that I'm really glad to be here. I'm with you all. I know many of you, and but I'm glad to be in a different environment with you outside of Letterman Printing. So if my face looks familiar, that's where I'm from, Letterman Printing. So thank you for the invitation this morning, Pastor Hart, to be here with you, and I'm going to enjoy many more days with you all.
Thank you. Have a seat. Following worship, I'll invite Bridget to stand here with Pastor Cheryl as you make your way to Molyneux Lounge, and you can welcome her personally. We're delighted to have her today and in the days ahead. Now for a minute for mission from Sue Wilson, please.
Good morning, everybody. Many of you have been asking about the results of the rummage sale that ended last week. We felt it was very successful. We were able to make $2,200 for mission. Thank you all for your contributions. Some of you are interested in what happened to what was left over. We sent the soiled items to the animal shelter. We sent several boxes of things to the Dove House for battered women. We sent satchels down to children's services for children that are going into foster care. We had a person come by that was for a mission for the homeless in Cincinnati, and we gave her the leftover blankets. The remaining is going to the Salvation Army, so everything's going to be dispersed. I want to make all the women aware that this afternoon at 2:30, the fall gathering is going to take place in the Molyneux. And we're going to have Holly Gage come and talk about her experience on the hospital ship, the Mercy ship. Holly is supposed to be here this morning. There she is. Welcome, Holly. We'll see you later this afternoon. I hope we have a great turnout. It's going to be a wonderful program. Thank you.
Let us now present ourselves to the God we worship.
Please stand, if able, and join me in the call to worship. Sing, all people of God, sing the good news. We cry ourselves to sleep, and God comes down and dwells to awaken us with joy's embrace. Sing in every land, in every tongue, sing the good news. When our lives bottom out, God takes us by the hand to lead us into the light. Sing in heaven and on earth, sing the good news. Broken, hopeless, lost, we cry out to God who hears our hearts. Sing, all people of God. We have sing the good news of a new life in Christ Jesus our Lord. Remain standing for hymn 749.
Thank you. And the peace of Christ be with you all.
And also with you.
I invite you to stand and share that peace with one another.
Over here. Yes, sort of neat fishing equipment we have here. Welcome to all you. My name is Lee Fisher. I'm the appointed storyteller for today. And I've decided that we would talk a little bit about love. If those of you that have noticed, love has been prominent in almost every sermon that we've heard from the pulpit. It's also prominent in both of those hymns that we sang today, I should say. So, who do you have in the audience that loves you?
Madeline, probably my mom.
My grandma.
My grandma.
Do you think that you can love someone that you don't know? You think that's possible? For those of you that were shaking your heads no, I'm going to show you something. Because people come to a place like this, and because they listen to what's said, I would like all of those in the audience that think they could show love and concern for these children to raise their hands. Look at that. Stand up so you can see. Stand up so you can see who they are. Keep them up there for a few more seconds. Turn around. What's going on with the choir? Just a way of showing that that's possible. Some of these people out there, you don't know who their names are. No? You may never know who their names are. But because we're gathered in a place like this, and a lot of us have been coming to a place like this for a long, long time, we know that when someone asks us that question, we could always raise our hands and say yes. And I'd like you to remember that you don't have to know someone to love them. So, let's gather in our little circle. Oh my gosh, this is all confusing to me every week. There. You got it right? So before we turn around, we're going to say to the congregation,
can you read that?
May God be with you here. Can you say that?
May God be with you here.
And the congregation says,
may God be with you here.
Okay, turn around. Off to class. Well, that was sort of right. Thanks, everyone, and have a good Sunday.
Let's be contemplative for the prayer of illumination. Guide us in the path of discipleship so that as you empower us by your word, we may be a blessing for others, bringing the promise of the kingdom near by our words and deeds. Amen. The first reading is from 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verses 17 to 20. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has gone, the new has come. All this is from God, who reconciled us to himself through Christ and gave us the ministry of reconciliation, that God was reconciling the world to himself in Christ, not counting men's sins against them. And he has committed to us the message of reconciliation. We are therefore Christ's ambassadors, as though God were making his appeal through us. We implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God.
The gospel lesson today comes from John chapter 21, verses 1 through 14. Listen for the word of the Lord. After these things, that is, after Jesus presenting himself in various ways to the disciples, he presented himself to them one more time by the Sea of Tiberias, and this is how it all came about. Peter, Simon Peter, and Thomas, who was also called the twin, and Nathanael from Cana of Galilee, and the sons of Zebedee, and two others of the disciples were together when Peter said to them, "I'm going fishing." So they said to him, "We'll go with you." So they went down to the sea and got in the boat, and they fished all night. All night. And they caught nothing. Just after daybreak, Jesus stood on the beach and he said, "Children, you haven't any fish, have you?" And they said, "No." So Jesus said, "Cast your net over on the right side of the boat and you will catch some." So they cast the net, and when they pulled it up, they had so many fish that they couldn't even get the net into the boat. And then the disciple that Jesus loved said, "It's the Lord." And Peter jumped up and put on his clothes because he was naked, and he jumped into the sea. And the disciples, they followed along, hauling that net behind them because they weren't really that far from the shore, only about 100 yards. When they got to the beach, they saw that there was a charcoal fire. And on the fire was bread and fish. And Jesus said to them, "Bring some of the fish you've caught." So Peter got back in the boat, and he hauled the fish on the shore. And there were 153 of them. And Jesus said, "Come and have breakfast." So he took the bread and he gave it to them and also the fish. Now this was the third time that Jesus showed himself alive to the disciples after he was raised from the dead. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Do we have any people here today who love to fish? Is there anyone out there? Is there anyone? We have some people who love. Cornelia catches them by the dozens, I know, but you got to go to Canada with her to do that. I got another question about fishing. Do we have any people here who could tell a fish story? Now, just how big was that fish? I think it would be an interesting fellowship experience. Interesting fellowship experience if we just divided people up into small groups and asked everybody to tell a fish story. Now, we would find that Presbyterians could tell stories if we did that, couldn't we? Fish stories seem to be at the very heart of the gospel that Jesus came teaching and proclaiming. Can't you recall at least some of the stories in the gospel in which fish figured prominently? You remember the one about the little boy? Do you remember when Jesus had thousands of people who came out to hear him preach in the wilderness? And what did the little boy bring that day when they realized they didn't have enough food? What? How many?
Two.
Fish stories. We could go on and on about fish stories in the Gospels. So I'll share a couple this day. When our son Daniel was maybe about 5 years old, he had his first fishing lesson. I don't know when you had your first one, but he was about 5 years of age when he had his first fishing lesson. You can never start too soon, by the way. Am I right, Cornelia? You can never start too soon learning how to fish. We did it at the small farm of Bill and Dorothy Smith, who are members of our church who lived a few miles outside of town. It was an adventure land for all three of our sons, and to this very day, I can't tell all the things that we did for Cheryl to know about. I'm astonished at some of the things we did. Bill Smith was a Navy veteran of World War II, and had been a scoutmaster for a lot of years in his life, and when I became a scoutmaster, Bill taught me lots about how to succeed at that particular leadership endeavor. I learned from him early on that he loved children and he loved animals. And he liked to say that he got along best with people and animals. Adults, not so much. Bill was kind of a cantankerous sort, and he was right about getting along with children and adults, and he did love them. And once you got past that gruff exterior, he was really a delightful person. Now, you probably never had any cantankerous people here to see what that is like, am I right? Let me tell you, it's a wonderful experience. One day I took Daniel out to Bill and Dorothy's house, their farm, for a pastoral visit, and Daniel wanted to go along, so I said, sure. And while we're out there, Bill said to me, well, why don't we just take a walk down to the pond, and I'll teach Daniel how to fish. You haven't done that yet, have you, Pastor Hart? And boy, I felt inadequate as a pastor and a dad at that moment, but but he said, sure, we'll teach that boy how to fish. And I still, to this very day, can recall what it was like when Bill took a line fishing rod like this and a hook, and we dug up some worms, and then he showed Daniel at 5 years of age how to hook that thing. And then we began to see our son fish. Bill and I sat back under a big shady oak tree that day, and Daniel walked out on the pier that went out into the pond. Bill said, I guarantee that boy's going to catch a fish today. All of my fish have been caught several times. Several times. He'll catch one. Bill and I commenced to talking and sharing about different things, keeping an eye on Daniel, who was about halfway down the pier. His line was out in the middle of the pond, and after a while we started to see that line growing tighter, taut, if you know what I mean. And then before you know it, we started to see a tug on the pole at that particular time. And Bill said, I bet he's got that old catfish of mine again. He loves worms. We feed him real good. We watched and wondered what would happen. And Bill said, don't worry about it. That fish knows how to behave. I watched, and pretty soon I began to see Daniel and his pole moving toward the end of the pier, and suddenly he began to pick up speed, and I said goodbye to Bill as I ran to catch my son just before he got to the very end of the pier. I grabbed the pole, and we began walking back until we fell over on the shore and dragged that fish to dry land. Bill was doubled over in laughter, rolling on the ground. And my son said to me, "Dad, look what I did. I caught a big fish, about half his size." It raises an interesting thought, that experience on a beautiful summer day long years ago. Who's catching whom? You know what I mean? Who's doing the catching? It really might be one of the most interesting spiritual questions of our day, don't you think? Who really is being caught by what? Who's doing the catching? Who's doing the fishing? What are we being drawn to? What is hooking our lives? Can you think about that? Who's doing the catching? Now, you may or may not know this, but the fastest growing spiritual group in the United States today is a group called the Nuns. I don't mean nuns on the bus. Nuns, N-O-N-E-S, it means exactly what it says. Increasing numbers of people who look at established religion and say, I don't want any part of that. I want none of that. You've heard that term, perhaps. Maybe you've heard it. Some of those folks who count themselves as nuns have sometimes been hurt by the church. There are people sometimes who've been, I hate to tell you this, bored by the church. There are people at times who have no interest in being caught up by us, because I hate to tell you this, increasing numbers of people, it pains me to say this, but increasing numbers of people doubt whether the church is the people and the place to grow their spirituality. Have you ever encountered that? People, the nuns, spiritual but not religious, who haven't given up on faith or spirituality, far from it, they just wonder if the people of God, the church, is a place to grow spiritually. Now, that's hard to hear, isn't it? Is that hard to hear for you? Is that hard to think about, that being sometimes how people look at Oxford Presbyterian Church? They wonder, is that a group of people where I can really grow in my faith and spirituality? Is it? We have to ask ourselves another question about that. Do we believe, in fact, that we have a compelling way of life to offer other people? Do we, in fact, believe that we are passionately living that way of life together in such a way that it will draw people not just to ourselves, but to the living Christ? You see, we can get confused about that. What we are about is trying to present the living Christ in such a way that others are drawn to him, just as we are to be drawn to him. Is our way of life that compelling? I would ask for you gathered here today, has that been true in your experience here in this congregation? Have you been drawn to Christ in such a way that it's made a difference in changing your life? I would even ask, what caught you and drew you here? And I would even ask, what keeps you hooked? That was a pun, by the way. You see, at the very heart of the Christian life is an invitation. What did Jesus say? Follow me, and what? I will make you fishers of people. We used to say fishers of men, but I'm looking out on the audience, and it looks like quite a few women heard that call too. Thank God. Follow me, and I will make you fish for people. It means this, at a minimum. if our passion for reaching people outside the church is not as passionate and committed and energetic as our passion for loving each other, then we've lost sight of Jesus' calling for us. You see, we have to have a passion just as intense to love other people. I love what Lee Fisher said. Can you imagine loving people you don't know? Right on. Because when Jesus says, I want you to go and fish for people, he's saying, I want you to go out and meet people you've never known before in your whole life. Because my message of love and good news will lead you to know each other and to love one another. That's the power of the gospel. That's a fish story worth telling again and again. How were we caught by that vision? Our gospel story today opens with the disciples gathered together, probably before nightfall, on the shore by the Sea of Tiberias. And Peter says, as Pastor Cheryl recited that story, I'm going fishing. I'm going fishing. And the other disciples say, we'll go with you too. And so the disciples went out and got into the boat. But as the story unfolds, we know that night, what? They caught nothing. Kind of discouraging for fishermen, fisherwomen at times to catch nothing after you've been out all night, but that's a part of fishing too, to be patient, to wait, to be present, never knowing exactly when you'll get a bite, when you'll catch a fish. Just after daybreak, we learn Jesus stood on the beach, but the disciples did not know that it was Jesus. They did not know that it was the risen Lord who was there on the beach gazing at them. Just a few yards out in the sea. Now you may wonder, how can this possibly be? How could the disciples, after being with Jesus maybe up to 3 years, day in and day out, sharing and breaking bread together, witnessing, serving, healing, testifying, how could they not recognize him? How's that possible? How could that happen? Until we recall how Mary, when she went to the empty tomb where Jesus was raised from the dead, mistook Jesus for the gardener, the risen Christ. She thought he was just a gardener out there tending the garden. Or we remember perhaps another resurrection story when Jesus goes into the locked room with the other disciples. And Thomas, after a while, says, I don't believe it's you until I touch the wounds in your side. If we're tempted to think that we would never be so thick-headed in failing to identify Christ, the gospel story reminds us, actually, there's a good chance we'll be just as slow to recognize Christ as they were long years ago. Recently, a pastor friend of mine spoke about how his son Teddy, who just turned 30 years of age, is the clearest sign of the presence of Christ in his life of any relationship he's ever known. Now, my friend Pastor Tom's son, Teddy, is a young man age 30 with multiple disabilities that he's had since the very beginning of life. Multiple disabilities. And yet my friend Tom says he is the clearest sign of the presence of Christ of anyone he's ever known in his life. And others who know Tom and know his son Teddy have been touched and moved by that very same experience and expression of love. They look at how Tom and his wife love their son Teddy and they think, this is about as close to recognizing the presence of Christ as anything I've ever seen. You ever had that kind of experience? Ever had that kind of experience? Jesus would say, you can recognize me in all kinds of places, all kinds of people, and usually it's the people you least expect it, that when you see those in prison, I'm there with them. When you see those who are hungry and naked and poor and struggling, the people we so condescendingly say are poor and aren't deserving of our love, Jesus says, I'm with them. If you want to see who I am in the world, go and serve them. It's a good way, I think, to think about church.
Is church the people and the place? Is church the people and the place who help me to see Christ in other people, who help me to see Christ in myself? Isn't that an interesting way to think about church? Is church the people and the place who help me to see Christ in my own life? Because oftentimes I can't. And is church the people and the place who help me to see Christ in my brothers and sisters, not only here, but also out in the world? Isn't that a wonderful definition of church? You see, I happen to think that that would draw people to Christ if we really deeply believe that about ourselves and what we're called to be and do, that that's what the church is all about. So standing there on the beach watching the disciples try to catch fish, Jesus asked them that provocative question, "Children, have you caught any fish yet?" I pondered over that for a little while and I thought, that sounds kind of grating. It kind of irritates me. You ever walked up and down a beach, watched people fishing off the beach shore, and they've been there all day, and you walk past their buckets, and you look in, and you see, have you had any luck today? And they'll look you up and down and say, well, what do you think? What do you think? Haven't you caught any fish? Popular Bible commentator William Barclay tells us that where Jesus is standing on the shore, he's actually serving as a kind of spotter for fish out in the Sea of Tiberias. You see, the glare of the sun and the churning of the water and the waves means that the disciples, while they're in their boat, because of the glare of the light and the churning of the water, aren't able to look directly down and see any fish. Can you imagine that being true? So Jesus is on the shore and he has a different angle of vision, and he's a spotter. He can actually see where the fish are when they can't. And so what does he say? You've been fishing where? On the wrong side of the boat. Put your net on the other side. And they do, and they catch a magnificent load of fish, 153, which some have said is an indication of the breadth of the gospel of Jesus Christ, touching all people, all conditions of humanity throughout the whole wide world. Lots of things, I believe, can serve as a glare to prevent us from seeing the people Jesus invites us to see. Ever thought about that? We can actually not see people who are there that Jesus wishes us to see and love. We can fail to look at times in the direction of human need and witness in the church because we make the priority of our own needs first and foremost. In fact, every church I've ever served has said about the same thing. Pastor Hart, once we've taken care of the needs of our people, then we'll focus on the needs of people in our community. And I say, really? Once you've attended completely to the needs of your people, then you'll address the needs of people in your community. And I say, really? There's another way I've experienced people in the church encountering glare and not seeing the people that Christ would have us see. And I've got to say this with a certain degree of sensitivity. With a certain degree, we love our church buildings, don't we? This is a beautiful one. It's a beautiful facility. I like being here, don't you? It's filled with great memories of baptisms and weddings and services of witness to the resurrection and all kinds of memories of what it means to be together as God's people. But we can sometimes experience glare because of our focus on our buildings. We focus so intently on our buildings that we can't see people outside. Have you ever thought that? Have you ever wondered if that is also a challenge for us to face? I think that Jesus does want us to come together and worship and to enjoy this kind of place, but we've got to address the glares that prevent us from seeing the people God would have us see. So let me offer to you what I see. At Miami University, there are 18,000 students who are attending classes just a few blocks away from us, several thousand professors and staff, the support personnel as well, over 20,000 people affiliated with the university. And I ask, how can we possibly ignore this population? I want to ask and suggest that maybe we've been fishing on the wrong side of the boat, and that we actually need to turn our attention to the huge numbers of people who populate our town seeking to learn and grow in their own lives. How can we ignore them? How? What I want to say is, this is your mission field. This is where this congregation needs to be fishing. In July, at the Big Tent National Conference in Knoxville at University of Tennessee, we heard Jason Santos, National Collegiate Ministry Staff at General Assembly, make this challenging statement. Five of us heard it. He said, "If your church fails to reach out in witness and service to students and faculty and others in your college town, you are failing at your missional calling." That was a tough thing to hear, I want you to know. But he was saying we've got to be fishing on the right side of the boat that Jesus would call us to fish. As this fish story in John's gospel begins to draw to a close, I love that image. This is just a suggestion. 153 fish. Think about it. They didn't just jump into the boat all by themselves. They had to be drawn. That's the mission calling of us as the people of God. We've got to be fishing and drawing people to Jesus Christ. The conclusion of the fish story is telling in many ways. When they'd gone ashore, they saw a charcoal fire there with fish on it and bread, and Jesus says to them, "Come, eat and be fed." Because he knows that in the fishing enterprise, we need to be strengthened and fed for the work. And so this is my understanding of what I think Jesus is calling us to be recommissioned for. If you, as the people of God in this place, want to catch people up in a compelling vision for the future of this church, then live like your very life depends on fishing for other people, because your very life does depend on that practice. Amen. In our sharing time, you've been invited to ponder what has caught you and drawn you to this church. The response is people who've made a difference in your faith life. And I've been here long enough to know that there are lots of people who've helped shape the faith life and service and witness of all kinds of people here. Am I right? Wonderful saints. People who really have drawn us to Christ. And so I'm not going to ask you to share a lot of stories about that, but just to briefly lift up the names of some saints living and some saints who've passed on to glory, who've helped to shape the life and witness of this congregation. Please just voice their names loudly, if you would. John and Kit. Mary Dodd. David Dunderdahl. Mabel Kramer, Virginia Shoewalter, Robert Foster, Barbara Barnes, Joe Hookey, Ellen, Prudana,
Kent,
Mark Barnes. I have a question. Has your life and shape, faith been shaped by children and youth in some way? About every Sunday, am I right? About every Sunday. People have told me their life and faith was shaped by the baptism of the Todd baby boy back there. He makes a wonderful Jesus, by the way. Anyone else? People who have shaped the life and witness of this church? Elaine Patterson. And we could go on. Katya. See, here's the thing. If people are going to be drawn to Christ, they also have to be drawn through other Christians and the lives of faith we lead. Isn't that so? That's so. I invite you to voice a few prayers of joy and concern at this time as well. Joys and concerns. Other joys and concerns.
Concerns for the people in the path of Hurricane Patricia.
People in the path of Hurricane Patricia. Lord, in your mercy, hear these prayers. Let me invite Pastor Cheryl now to share a little bit more about an upcoming opportunity to fish for people. Yes, indeed.
So you don't go to sleep. Everybody stand up. Really quickly. If you're able, if you have already decided, I am coming to the Tuesday worship service and I'm coming to the learning that goes with it at 6 o'clock and for dinner, you may sit down. Now, if you have not made up your mind yet, or if you're only coming, if you're coming just for the worship, sit down. Because that's okay too. You can come just for the worship. The rest of you may sit down. The ushers are coming along with another opportunity for you to pass out flyers or send them in the mail. We would like to know how many people are coming to the meal. We hope that we will have at least 75 people here for the service. Kent has lined up musicians. We have musicians from the university, instrumentalists, vocalists. It's going to be a wonderful night. It's going to take a core of people from this church to be here to provide the welcome and the core of people for this worship service. So if you have not decided to come, please consider this as an opportunity for you to support something new that's happening in your church and a new outreach to the community. The little flyer has just a little bit more about who our teacher leader is for that evening, and it also has an opportunity for you to let us know that you're coming or send it to a friend and say, thought you might like to be a part of this. Thank you.
And every one of us here in this place of worship and service has been caught up by the vision of Jesus Christ, your Son. He still calls us to follow him and to fish for other people that they might also be caught up in a vision of life in the kingdom of God as it comes more fully into our world. Let us be those people who seek to reach out to others in word and in deed that they might be drawn to you.
Bless also these gifts that we are about to share. In your strong and saving name we pray. Amen. Freely you have received, let us freely give.
God is our refuge and strength.
Please join together in the prayer of dedication for these gifts. Receive these gifts, O God, and transform us through them, that we may have eyes to see, eyes to understand, not only what you do on our behalf, but what you call us to do for your kingdom. Amen.
Now may the grace, mercy, and peace of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit rest and abide upon you all, both now and forever. And God's people said, Amen. Amen. Go now and serve the Lord.